Howdy, folks. Project introduction time. Got a little 1930s refrigerator here. It is really interesting. Got a neat door handle design. Just like that. There's a spring in each hinge. Kicks the door open. Push button for the latch. Little evaporator in there, about the size, I think, of like a CK1 monitor top. You look at the control, it's about the same control as a CK monitor top. Let's take a look under the hood. So this is interesting. It's clearly an open drive or a belt drive. The motor itself has a flywheel and a pulley and a fan. Got some interference going on there. The compressor is a welded case belt drive compressor. That is definitely not something that you see. You got a dome on it just like you would an electric hermetic compressor welded into a base plate. But then if you look in here, there's a seal carrier with bolts on it. So definitely a hermaphrodite design for sure. And I hope I am able to service the seal, because you can see there's a lot of oil around here. And every time I move this, I smell SO2. So obviously the seal is in need of attention. If we look down in here, if you like Winston's, you got a bunch of Winston cigarettes. Somebody was probably hiding their stash in there, smoking when they weren't supposed to. Get a good look at the serial number plate down there. It says General Electric Refrigerating Machine. Also got a GE motor, 1/6 horsepower. It is definitely barn fresh, or attic fresh. The owner bought an old house, forget what city it was in, maybe Chicago, and this was in the attic of the house. So somebody must have got a bigger model or a newer model and just stashed this in the attic, forgot about it. It's a high side float. You open this up, we have the same service port that the monitor tops have, the ones that have the high side float. So all indications are this is a 1937 or 38 model, which I find so strange, because GE had the CK monitor top by that point, and they had the flat top, they had the hermetic SO2 compressor that proved so reliable. So I don't understand why this exists. That's what I don't understand, why this actually exists. And one thing I wonder is if it is a General Electric branded refrigerator as a whole, or if another company made the cabinet and just bought GE's cooling machine to put in it. I don't know. This came in here today and I'm still learning about it. So one of the things is the unit sits on springs, and one of the springs over here is off, so that's why we have interference. So I'm going to try to get that spring hooked back up where everything will float like it's supposed to, and try to get a belt on this thing. And I'm going to put the camera battery on the charger while I do that, so I'll come back and show you guys what the results are. So I got the spring put in place. Now this is suspended and not rubbing. I put a temporary link type belt on there. You see all this turn smoothly. The original cord is in really poor condition. So I cut it back till I got a spot that seemed to be reasonable. And I tied in a test cord. So I'm going to plug it in the switch box here. This is unrehearsed. I have not tried to run it. So we'll see. I don't even know if the motor will run. We're going to see. It's running. That's encouraging. 3.9 amps. Feeling for any warmth, which I don't feel. Only trouble is I don't feel any air coming out. So the motor's running the wrong way. You probably can't tell on the video due to frame rate, but it was turning this way. And that is going to try to push air out through that part of the radiator. Now, looking at the shape and curvature of those fan blades, that's not the right way for that fan to rotate. I don't know if there's some failure going on with the motor that caused that, or if someone has gone in here and done something to the wiring. But if I'm not mistaken, this is a rotary compressor, and it would absolutely not work running the wrong way. It might damage it, so that's why I shut it right down. So I'm going to investigate the motor a little bit and see if I can get the direction of rotation changed. So I took the motor cover off and took the cord out. And there's two black wires in there that come from within the motor and then go back to the studs on the motor. In general, this type of motor, if you interchange those two wires, internal wires, it reverses the motor. So I'm going to try to do that. And then make another test run to see if we get a different result with the compressor. So the plan for this fridge is to completely refurbish it, the cooling part of it and the cabinet. So this is going to all come out of here and be cabinet will be taken somewhere to be refinished while I redo the cooling unit here. I'm going to do my absolute best to keep this original compressor, but if being a welded open drive compressor, if I cannot fix the shaft seal, then you know it might have to go back with a different compressor. Now you all know that I cut open and re-weld electric compressors. But the first one of any type that you try to cut open like that, there's a very high likelihood that first one is not repairable, because there's no instructions from the manufacturer on how to cut it open without damaging the internals or contaminating it. And sometimes you got to learn that through a very steep learning curve. And this compressor is really only the only one like it that I've seen, other than pictures, and I don't think any of my collector buddies have cut one open. So hopefully the shaft itself is not one of the seal faces for the mechanical seal. That's my fear. If the shaft itself is a wear part and I can't get it out of the compressor to machine it, then I won't be able to redo the mechanical shaft seal. But if that is not the case, and there's a bushing that comes off from the front underneath the collar, then there's a good chance that I'll be able to recondition the seal. And I am going to go through this motor to do a correct repair on it. But for now, again, I'm just trying to do minimum functionality testing. I'm not going to bother with the original controller wiring because it's just so decayed. I'm going to use the test cord here. This has its own circuit breaker in it. So all the original wiring is out of the way. And I want the fan, everything to turn this way, So the fan is drawing through the condenser. Go for a start up here. Sounds better. Feeling for any warmth in the lines? I do feel a little temperature difference between the two. One thing though, you see those two lines there? That's oil being thrown out, which is a bad sign. Do hear something. Just feeling for cooling. Got pretty good air coming out of the fan. This line is definitely cooler than this line, but it's not getting hot like it would be if there was actually a charge in it. I'm going to let it run a few minutes to help kind of maybe let that shaft seal wear in a little bit. Maybe it won't leak as much. And get the hermetic service kit on here. See what kind of pressure's left in there. Well, I put the top back on it because you see those little dots on the floor down there? That's oil spots. I was throwing them on this other fridge cabinet. I decided I would cover the top of it up. And then a few minutes ago, I stopped back by here to look and the power to current demand was up on the motor. So I opened the door and it is cooling and we have frost on the evaporator right there. The float outlet line is frosted up and this entire top cover, the top plate is frosted, is coming down the side. I'm just blown away. I cannot believe that there's still sulfur dioxide in there, at least enough to go in the float chamber and open the float and start freezing the evaporator. That's, wow, that's just amazing. Obviously, it's not going to last because it was leaking around the shaft seal. I know it will leak out, but we're just going to get to enjoy and see this 1937 or 38 open drive system work again. It is coming across the bottom now. It's actually cooling and working. It's just amazing to me. I hope y'all are enjoying this as much as I am. And oil slinging be damned, we're gonna get to watch it work. So I'm assuming this is a high side housing compressor and it had to mechanically generate heat and get the vapor to start coming out. Because this line is warm now, this one's ambient, but this one's getting very warm and we got a lot of heat rejection. So some really interesting findings. It's at some point in the past, someone worked on the motor. You look at this end housing, it's turned 90 degrees. So this open slot right here is supposed to be at the bottom. On this one here, you can see how it's at the bottom. And we have the oil fill cap here. On this other end of the motor, the oil fill cap is turned sideways. So someone had this motor apart. They might have taken it to a motor shop. I don't know. See, there's a wire, like a tag wire. So possibly motor went to a motor shop and it came back and the rotation wires were reversed. And of course, the rotary compressor only works in one way. So once that mistake was made, this never worked again. And it sat in that attic for no telling how many decades until today. And now it's getting an opportunity to work again. It's almost up to the header. Well, unfortunately, my camera battery is going out, so I'm going to charge the camera and let this thing run for a while. You can look down in here and see a puddle of oil coming out from the back. And you can look on this aluminum cabinet and see oil spots that are being thrown. And you can look on the floor, all those little dots is oil that's been thrown out. So this is what normally happens with these old belt drives if they've been sitting a long time. Sometimes they still have a charge, but there's etching and corrosion on the shaft seal from sitting in one spot. And when you start running them, usually they leak. Sometimes after an hour or so, the seal will kind of lap itself in and the leak will stop, but this has not happened. This one's continuing to leak. We do have a full frost on here, which again, this is amazing that it sat in storage for all this time. And the SO2 did not leak out around that shaft seal. But it's frosted all the way up here to the return line. I mean, that's just unheard of. Definitely a very well-made product. All right, gonna move on to tear down. Get this thing ready for refinishing. So I pulled the machine off of that cabinet and it'll fit on a monitor top cabinet. Now this is a size 2 cabinet, so there's a gap, but a CK1 machine fits exactly the same on here. I go back over here to this cabinet. It's made just like a monitor top, have the same no oxide cloth, same gaskets. I mean, it's really, there's the Thermocraft paper insulation. It's made exactly like a monitor top. Again, I don't understand why GE would make this when they had already evolved so far past this design, but that's what makes it a really unique, cool piece. So taking the door apart, you can see the insulation is this Thermocraft paper. Much of these old fridges was made of natural materials like this, that, you know, cellulose and other similar natural materials. No fiberglass, no asbestos, just paper. Whole cabinet's insulated with that. Well, there's all the sheet metal taken off of it. Got the top cover, the door skin, the air duct on the back, and the feet off of it. And we've got a serial number and a type, HE4B. Probably be able to get more about the year it was manufactured based on that. The condition of this cabinet is amazing. It's never had wet insulation. It's been kept dry. I haven't neglected defrosting and let water run down in the bottom. No rust, no dents. It's just really nice. This fridge is spread all over the shop. And I think this is a good stopping point for part one in the video. I will pick back up with mechanical restoration in the next segment. Thank you so much for watching.